Well, this is an all-electron code. You heard that before, and we started this in 2004. Actually, my reason for doing this, and I think the others too, was specifically that we wanted to get reliable calculations for the entire periodic table at reasonable cost. And for various reasons, we chose to go all-electron at the time. And one particular reason was that we knew that we could. In fact, there were tests done before my time in Berlin with a DMOL code that showed that this prescription of numeric atom-centered orbitals was actually quite promising in terms of stability and all-electron accuracy. And so that's why we started this. So this is the objective, to try and capture the full space of materials and chemistry. One advantage is that we can do non-periodic and periodic models on equal footing. So the whole of molecular space is also available to us. And as I said, the goal from the beginning was to have high numerical precision and reliability, and also actually to be scalable, so to do large calculations. And in fact, that's probably one of the strengths of the code, that for some things, especially hybrid functionals, we can do very large band structure calculations at essentially converged accuracy as far as you'd want it to be converged. At least I'd want it to be converged for structures of 700 or maybe 1,000 atoms if we have a supercomputer that's large enough. This pushes the limits, but it's actually worth it if one can do it. And then there are lots of practical approximations to the full Dirac equation, which is density functional theory, many body perturbation theory in various instances, and so on, and everything else that we try to work on. In particular, spin orbit coupling will be a topic in a moment, but not just. So I've shown slides like this for a long time. I was going to go to this only very briefly, since the basis sets came up before. I will say a little bit more about this. So this was shown in a similar variant already at the APS March meeting in 2006, when I, for the first time, talked about numeric atom-centered orbitals at all, I think. And at least Don was in the audience at the time. I remember that. And the construction of these basis sets cost me a little bit of thought for a while, and eventually it became a very simple exercise to create a library. So eventually a library of fixed basis functions, but if you want to create a library of basis sets, you need an optimization target. And it turns out that in order to generate good basis sets for density functional theory in the ground state, which includes hybrids, it turns out in the end, a very simple target function works, which is to create the simplest possible chemical bond, which is to take non-self-consistent potentials of dimers and put these at different distances, so that you actually keep a physical range of binding distances, some too short, some too long, and try to minimize the total energy. And so the trick is to have a large pool of basis functions. In the end, we settled for lots of different shapes that were theoretically possible, hydrogenic functions with variable nucleus or ionic functions, and start with an atomic minimal basis with a set of dimers, calculate, add a basis function to the basis set, calculate the total energy, add another basis function, calculate the total energy again, see which one is lower. Once you're through the pool, select the lowest energy basis function, and then go through the pool again. And so then you end up with curves that look like this. So this is for hydrogen, oxygen, and gold, and this is the basis set size. This is a logarithmic scale of the total energy error. And so if you try this for hydrogen, you find the minimal basis here at about 100 millielectron volts per atom. And then you add a single S function, which is quite reasonable, and you go down quite significantly in total energy error. And this S function has a particular Z, and then you add a P function, and the total energy goes down again. And then the algorithm selects another S function, P, D function, S function, and so on. And you go, and this was important to us if you targeted the accuracy here, you go below 1 millielectron volt and perhaps lower. So eventually you run out of flexibility, and that's basically it. And you can do this for all elements, this kind of construction strategy. And this is useful because the computer tells you a few things that you would forget. For instance, for zinc, it turns out the computer would like to put two P functions relatively early in the strategy because it actually doesn't have a P valence shell as an atom, but you need it for the bonding. And so you need more flexibility. And so this automated strategy fixed a few things that I might have missed had I done it by hand. Anyway, so for a long time I showed a lot of benchmarks, and this is the point of this particular slide. And then eventually, thankfully, the Delta Factor project came along, and that fixed the problem for me because we had a benchmark that we could look at, and thankfully, as I said before, it turns out that worked. So in fact, tests were done by Marcin Dulac in Denmark, who's very good, but who had not developed AIMS and who had access to the manual and the code, and asked me a few questions like how to set up BCC Chromium. But that was essentially it. And so for the largest basis sets that he tested, you saw that value before, that worked quite well. So we ended up among the other all-electron codes within the range that's probably numerically indistinguishable. And I'm quite happy about this because we didn't move since that project began. So for the tier 2 basis sets, this was fine. We also have the normal production settings, tight and light. And there, you can always tweak something, so that helps. But for these basis sets, we didn't have to do anything. So this is an accurate method, and then there's something that Stefan will talk about tomorrow that he drafted me into, actually, for which I'm quite grateful because I learned a lot, which is you can do total energies, of course, too, not just basically curves of energy differences. And so Stefan introduced me to Luca Frediani and Stig Jensen, who wrote a multi-resolution wavelet code. And they had done benchmark calculations with that code to below millihartree accuracy with the wavelets for 211 molecules of light elements, non-relativistic, so we would all agree on the kinetic energy operator, and LDA, PBE, and also hybrid functionals. And so this is very interesting because this is a hard target, and in fact, I have not seen a code, and exciting, I think, reaches the same accuracy now, but I had not seen a code before that ever that could reach that numerical accuracy routinely. So multi-resolution wavelets are the one method, if they become numerically efficient, that might actually make me switch one day. But I think so far they are not numerically as far-reaching as you can with the NAOs. But it's a highly good method. And so we did this, we were involved in this benchmark thanks to Stefan. And essentially the comparison included a number of Gaussian basis sets. Don't look too closely at these Gaussian basis sets because this becomes very controversial. Which Gaussian do you choose? A basis set. But on the FHIM side, it turns out that, of course, you could take something like the total energy error and converge this. This is in kcal per mole, however, per mole of molecules. So it's a somewhat larger factor for 40 millielectron volts per atom and then down. And you can converge this to small values. But more importantly, something like an atomization energy also goes down. And for the production type settings, although the heavier ones, so the tight settings, we actually end up with something in the few millielectron volts per atom on average for these molecules. I think this is consistent with the values that Claudia showed before. And so we were quite happy to see this because this actually works in practice. And it works for large systems also. So this is what we did. But of course, there's more that we should do. And so this is the benchmarking something else than just total energies part. And so we were, of course, interested in band structures. And we were interested in PBE and HSE. And so what I'll show and what we have is this data set that was created by William Hoon. And so this is the important message, actually, of this talk, that this data set is out there, and I think some people know this in the audience, of course, which consists of 103 compounds from lithium to bismuth. This is the list of the compounds that we chose over here. And we needed reference data. And so this is a hard problem, because you need somebody who you trust and who you know can produce reference data at the level that you want to get to. And so we chose Vint2K, because that's a code that I've trusted for a very long time. And I also had some past usage of it in my very far past. And so we calculated reference data, scalar relativistic, in PBE, and that I think, hopefully, are as converged as they get for these 103 compounds. And they are nomad. So if you want to test the scalar relativistic band structure, and there we should all agree, there should be no disagreement, then this data set is out there and in principle can be used for blanket testing. And Vint2K has the advantage that it also works for higher lying conduction band states, I think, if you let it. And then the second thing that we were really interested in was self-consistent spin-orbit coupling, because we were interested in doing spin-orbit coupled calculations, and for various reasons, we wanted to know how good is our method, which is non-self-consistent spin-orbit coupling, actually. And the reason it's non-self-consistent is not that this is the greatest we can do, but if you're already saddled with the cost of a hybrid functional and you want to do a large structure that contains even something like lead, it's still quite advantageous if you can do the calculation at all. And so if you try to do non-self-consistent spin-orbit coupling, that makes the calculation feasible in some cases, at least if you're doing 300 or 700 atoms. And so this is really a strong motivator to try and find out what is the accuracy of spin-orbit coupling. So in short, this is what this looks like. This is for gallium arsenide, and over here you have the NAOs versus the Vint2K reference data, and so this is a band structure we should get. And what you can see is that these lines are visually at the scale of 20 electron volts on top of each other up to relatively medium conduction band energies, and up here you see a small difference. And this is not surprising, because if you work with a basis set which is designed to be compact and designed to catch the valence states, and in fact low-lying conduction states, at some point it has to run out of flexibility. So this you can entirely fix by actually going to a larger basis set. This becomes more expensive, of course, but it can be done, so we tried, but deliberately this is the plot that we show, because this is where you see how this works. And so we can quantify that further by just doing the benchmark as a least squares energy between band structures for all 103 compounds. These are these points here, and they're ordered according to the maximum nuclear nuclear charge in the system. So this goes from lithium to bismuth. And you can see that we're, for the valence states, somewhere in the range of 10 millielectron volts or lower, and some alkali metals at the time appear to have had outliers that are slightly higher here. And this is still an interesting question where this came from. There could actually be a Wien 2K paper that explains this in terms of higher lying local orbitals. But anyway, the agreement is extremely good. So this is, if this is the agreement we want, this is fine. If you go to the conduction band states, you see that this becomes a little bit larger, and this is certainly not a Wien 2K thing. This is certainly where you would have to increase the basis set of FHR aims a little bit, and this can be done. But for this basis set, you see that we're somewhere in the 50 millielectron volt range up to 5 eV above the conduction band edge. And so this is something that's useful to know. It could be done, but at least it told us that we were doing the right thing by and large. More interesting is then spin orbit coupling. This is supposed to be a whole slide, not built up. And so here we have to go back to relativity, because very often we teach pseudopotentials. I don't actually for that reason. And we teach the Schrödinger equation to the students, and then spin orbit coupling sort of emerges bottom up as this operator that you use next, and it doesn't have a past. It does have a past, however, in terms of coming from the Dirac equation. And you should really be solving the Dirac equation, so this becomes somewhat tedious and difficult, and few people except for FBLOW do it. And so you can rewrite this, and this is well known, by solving for the small component here at the bottom and creating an equation that is now nonlinear for the large component, which is the electronic component which you're interested in. You get this relatively complicated looking expression, which does have a momentum operator, and it has something that looks like the spin orbit coupling operator. And then you can approximate this further. So this, in short, is a scalar relativistic term, and then this is the spin orbit term. And in our case, we're going to approximate this here by something called atomic Zora, which has worked extremely well for us as a scalar relativistic method for various reasons. So this is what's in the delta factor paper. But the spin orbit coupling operator is also expanded one more time by a Taylor expansion to look like this. In fact, it shouldn't, I believe, after having done this work. We should have not Taylor expanded. The usual spin orbit coupling operator, I think, is not what we should be using. But anyway, we do. And so this is what we do. And in Wien 2K, this whole thing can be done self-consistently. And so this is very helpful to compare. So if we compare, you see for the same range that I showed you before that in principle everything is really good up to things, up to basically cadmium or so. And then come the 5Ps, and they go up to maybe 50 millielectron volts. But in terms of what your experimental colleagues want out of semiconductors, this is not unacceptable. This is okay, especially if you're paying for the hybrid functional. That's the important bit. And then if you go to lead, bismuth, and so on, you get higher deviations up to 0.2 electron volts or so. Almost done. The point is that these deviations, of course, are quantitative, but the qualitative effect of the spin orbit coupling operator is much larger. This we can do by looking at band structures. This is an electron volt scale again, and so this is a non-spin orbit coupled version. The splitting here is electron volts. And so if you plot the error, which is plotted here on a scale of electron volts, for spin orbit splittings for these elements, you see that the error is about 10%, but the qualitative features are roughly correct. And so this was useful for us because we know where we stand with this non-spin orbit coupled band structure splitting. In principle, this can be done for other things, but I will come to the summary. And I think the most important thing is that this benchmark set is out there. It rests mostly on Wien 2K data. We also have an HSE data set built on FHR aims for both, because there, I think, we could not get that from a different reference code. So the HSE data are also available, but they're from FHRMs alone. And so this can be used, and hopefully we can use similar combinations for more things like this, which actually really help us in practical work, not just in principle. Thank you.